Welcome to this special webinar on target marketing. Today we have a very special discussion, which we do hear not very often from marketers. If you look at what marketers want, then what's the need of a marketer? The marketer wants the right audience, the right moment, and the right context. But what has happened over the years is that we have been obsessed with only two parts of it. One is the search engine part of it, and one is the social media part of it. And there's a space in between where the real, the diehard customer, the fan, the brand, the loyalist exists. And there are very few marketers who are addressing that particular consumer. And let me go a little bit back. We talk about all kinds of trends in marketing. We talk about experiential marketing. We talk about maybe, you know, the importance of a seamless marketing experience and all of that. But there's another thing, which is contextual marketing. I think we need to take marketing from a very emotional intelligence, like a military intelligence. You need to know your customer very well. Very few people do that kind of work. I think it's a very cut and paste kind of an approach that has been practiced by a lot of people on a lot of webinars, but here at E4M, we always bring you something different, a conversation that is different from what you would hear on other panels and webinars. Today, we are going to talk to two evangelists, Anjol Tyagi and Avirup Das, who call themselves the evangelists at Quora. They don't believe in those titles, the fancy titles, and they will talk about the importance of contextual marketing, target marketing, emotional recommendation. I just want to briefly tell you, what is the path to purchase for a customer? You don't go directly and buy, you don't listen to the salesperson directly, you do your own bit of research. There's a layer in between. That layer is very important. That warms you up for that sale, that purchase. And that's where these two young entrepreneurs function. So briefly, they're going to talk about what target marketing is, what Quora is doing in this space, how it is different from other marketing approaches. That's what they're going to talk about. But before that, I want to announce that we are running some polls while this conversation goes on. It will be up on your screen shortly, and you can also share your thoughts. And you can also ask some targeted questions. You know, you have the experts here. You have any questions on target marketing, they will be keen to answer, which will take towards the end of it. And we are live on Facebook, Twitter. You can also drop in your questions here. So without further ado, I would hand it over to Anjol and Avirup, and I'll just bring up that poll slide first. And before you start, this is the first poll slide. What kind of platform is Quora? And there are options, you can put in your answers here, and over to you.
Thank you so much, Rohil. That was a very warm and relevant introduction. Hey guys, welcome to this webinar. And what we're just going to do is, without further ado, jump into a presentation. So I'll start sharing my screen now. I hope you all can see my screen.
Yes, it's visible.
Cool. So thank you again, Rohil. That was very, very warm and very, very relevant. So yes, just to cover what we are essentially focusing on today, we are looking at the importance of target marketing. Right. And then we're looking at how target marketing and Quora are entwined together. We will then focus on the audience on Quora itself, specifically in India. And lastly, we will look at how therefore advertisers can drive their ROI goals on our platform. So to start with, what is target marketing? Right. We hear this term fairly often, but sometimes the nuance gets missed. Right. So to encapsulate, target marketing is all about breaking a market into segments where you can focus your marketing efforts on customers whose requirements closely match your products or services. So you're not targeting the entire audience that is available to you and hoping that the same messaging will deliver across all of the diverse audiences that are present to you. But instead, you focus your marketing efforts, you channelize them into segments, right? And this is typically divided into two ways of achieving the desired results. One is, of course, layers of demographic targeting, which is all about identifying the audience via their behavior in the entire online universe. That involves extended audience networks, that involves cookie placement. But as we all know, the world is moving away from that. Browser-based cookies, etc., will probably come to an end by around 2022. So what's next, right? How do we continue to present relevant messages to relevant audiences within specific segments? So the other aspect is contextual and behavioral in nature in terms of being able to target audiences at a point of time when they're receptive with relevant messaging. So how is target marketing therefore important, right? Targeting your audience at the right time and with the right context means that you're then targeting an audience, especially when they're the most receptive. We all know today that, especially as far as online advertising is concerned, we see a plethora of messaging across all websites, apps, and other platforms, which is largely consistent simply because of the fact that we are only looking at identifying audiences and their demographics, as opposed to tailoring messages with the right context. But differentiating yourself with the right context ensures that you're only reaching out to the audience at that point in time when they want to know more about your products and services. That naturally results in you being able to attract higher and better quality leads from your audiences because they're naturally more curious about your products and services simply because you've reached out to them at that time and with the right context as and when they were actually looking for relevant information related to your business. You therefore get to stand out because you had pre-identified your audience buckets and you tailored your messaging and you tailored your delivery. You will therefore be able to build in far greater customer engagement and you will see that customers naturally respond to you because they were already leaned in at the time when your messaging was delivered. And that allows you to essentially stay focused on your most receptive audience by iterating on the messaging that you deliver to ensure that you're always relevant to your most valuable audience. So we come to what is Kora and why do people come to the platform? Now Kora is fairly popular in India. So I'm guessing most of you would be aware of what the platform stands for and why people use it. But essentially people come to Kora to share knowledge and learn about the world. Kora connects the knowledge seekers with the subject matter experts. So, excuse me guys, I just need to close this window. Why are people typically coming to Kora? They're coming to Kora to be able to evaluate products. They're coming to conduct research. They're coming with a specific purpose of sharing their knowledge. They're coming to find community amidst other users who've had similar experiences. So you'll see that people are typically coming to Kora with a very set, predefined rationale or reason. And that allows us to therefore have a platform which has a very high intent audience. How we are differentiated today from most of the digital and social ecosystem is that Kora is neither purely a social platform, nor is it purely a search platform. It's an amalgamation of both of these intents because no one's coming to Kora to passively browse either family photos or cat videos. At the same time, no one's coming to Kora, very crucially, after they've already made up their mind, after they've already taken a decision. Instead, people are coming to Kora at that particular point in time when they're about to make a decision and they want to inform their decision-making process with credible and reliable opinions that they can find on Quora. That's the value that they find in the platform. And therefore, as businesses, when you're present on Quora in a contextually relevant environment at the right time, you get to essentially influence the decision-making journey of your customers while they're about to make that decision. So if you look at what the audience on Quora, especially in India, looks like, we have already crossed 100 million monthly active users on the platform in India. Quora's user base in India is second only to our user base in the US, where we have about 140 monthly active users. We became very large in the country very early on, and we've only grown substantially ever since. If we look at the age bifurcation of this audience on the platform, it's a good balance between a fairly millennial audience as well as a mature audience on the platform. So if you look at the 18 to 34 age group, that's about 70%+ of our audience. But if you also look at the 25 to 54 age group, that's about 60% of our audience. So fair balance between the millennials and the more mature audiences on the platform. Then if you look at the gender bifurcation for Quora in India, here you can see that we are a bit of a pleasant anomaly in comparison to most of the digital and social landscape in the country, right? So while typically most social or digital platforms in the country and globally typically have a far higher male skew, on Quora, as you can see, this is far more gender neutral in terms of distribution. And we like to believe that that's because Quora was constituted with a policy called BNBR, which stands for be nice, be respectful. So there are three levels of moderation that all Quora content gets passed through. There is automated moderation in the form of machine learning algorithms. There is manual moderation in the form of an extended moderation community. And after that, there is also user-generated moderation, where users can flag low-quality content. And when they do that, that content, when it is downvoted or reported, it automatically gets collapsed. Because of these safety mechanisms that we've built in, we typically see that Quora is a safer environment for people of all hues and colors to come and contribute as well as consume content in. If you look at the usage stats on Quora, this is fairly similar to what the overall digital landscape today looks like. So desktop usage is at a lower 15%, whereas mobile usage is at a much higher 85%. If you look at time spent on Quora, 40+ minutes are spent daily on the Quora app. App users comprise our core users, so they're deeply embedded into the engagement loop on the platform, and as a result, typically spend a lot more time on the platform. However, if you look at the total or average time spent on mobile, which excludes app usage, even that time is over 15+ minutes. This usage is via people coming through search or via our mWeb version. And the reason for this being so high as well is again linked to the high intent nature of our audience, where users are coming to Quora with a very specific purpose in mind to conduct research, to evaluate products, find community, to share their own knowledge. And because of that, till the time they haven't actually accomplished any of these goals that they specifically came to Quora for, they won't traditionally move away from the platform, leading to a greater average time spent on Quora. Finally, if you look at the unduplicated India reach across a lot of the prominent platforms today, where you're all probably advertising at the moment, if you look at, say, for example, LinkedIn, Reddit, Twitter, Pinterest, and Facebook, we actually have a very high level of unduplicated audience across these platforms. So what I mean by that is 68% of Quora's audience is not present on LinkedIn. 90% of Quora's audience is not present on Twitter. 82% of Quora's audience is not present on Twitter and Pinterest. And 34% of Quora's audience is not present on Facebook. If you look at content consumption as well as creation across a variety of categories, right? These are the typical consumption patterns across so many different categories on Quora. And while this is global in nature, you can see that there are certain specific kinds of topics which are surfacing here primarily because of the Indian interest across these topics, right? So you can see that while there is something like everyday life and dating and relationships, and higher education and politics. There's also Bollywood and cricket and entertainment, where primarily the audience comes from India. Similarly, there's something called cultural traditions, etc. So a fair mix of categories and content consumption on the platform. If you look at the India-specific data points as well, cutting cross categories, right? Finance, for example, is one of the most popular topic areas in Quora. And we'll just quickly go through each of these categories and the typical consumption patterns. What you're seeing on your left-hand side here is a screenshot of the finance topic on Quora. Now, while most of you may be aware of the question and answer format of the platform, what many don't know is that whenever a user contributes a question or an answer on the platform, they get to tag those questions and answers with what we call topics. So topics are a form of categorization of content, because each topic exists as its own page on Quora, where you can then go through all the questions and answers that have been tagged against that specific topic. Not only that, you can answer specific unanswered questions within the topic. You can see the most viewed writers within a specific topic, and you can also see related or associated topics to that particular topic that you're browsing. Plus, you can actually follow a specific topic to receive content in your home feed tailored from that topic, and also receive notifications from popular content within that topic. So think of a topic essentially as a high-powered version of a hashtag, where you can do so much more than just find all, say, tweets or posts, etc., comprising a specific hashtag. Within a topic, you can do that much more in terms of browsing content related to that specific topic or receiving content related to that specific topic. So for finance as a category, over 30 million answer views in Q1 of 2020 alone. Over 21 million followers of finance topics and over 365,000 questions. Similarly, banking specifically as a category within finance as well, over 31 million answer views in India alone in Q1 of 2020, over 2.3 million followers of the topic and over 356,000 questions. Insurance specifically as a category, again, absolutely massive. 5 million answer views in Q1 of 2020, over 98,000 followers, over 116,000 questions. If you look at education as a category, again, it's absolutely massive. It's one of the biggest categories of content creation consumption on Quora globally, and in India also. As you can see, over 38 million answer or content views in Q1 of 2020 alone, with over 16 million followers of education related topics and over 1 million questions answered on the platform. Similarly, software and SaaS as a category is also massive on the platform, with over 7 million answer views in India alone and over 1.6 million followers. And then we have over 300,000 questions against this topic. Even in B2B as a category, lots and lots of answer views. You can see as the slide enunciates, over 200,000 India answer views in Q1 of 2020 with over 300,000 followers and 13,000 questions. And you can see some of the questions that get asked within these specific topic sections. So we come to, how do you as a business, therefore, leverage not just this significant audience size, but also all of this audience intent that is absolutely unique to Quora? And what is also unique is how Quora mines all of this audience intent on the platform. So while I will showcase to you what are the products through which you can leverage this, Anjul will take over in terms of also explaining how you can reach that relevant audience to double down on target marketing within the Quora ecosystem. So three very simple ways to leverage Quora advertising. The easiest way to get started on the platform is what you see on the left-hand side here, which is text and image ads. This is a plug-and-play solution. We are a self-serve platform. So you can start with traffic campaigns or performance campaigns literally from the word go. You do not even need to have a profile on Quora in order to be able to do this. You just need to reach out to us and we enable a credit line for you. And then you can get started with performance goals or with traffic generation purposes. Then we have what we call the promoted answers feature, which requires you to be creating content on the platform. And then finally, what we have is the most evolved approach that you can take right now, where you can create a business profile on Quora. This is still a beta feature at the moment, And once you've created a business profile, then you can start answering questions from that business page on Quora. And then you can promote those answers as well as in parallel run text and image ads for your performance goals. So we'll quickly cover each of these ad types. Text ads are the most functional and one of the most native ad formats on the platform. What you get is very similar to what you have across other PPC platforms, where there is a headline copy and a body copy. The headline can be up to 65 characters, the body copy can be up to 105 characters, and you have a call to action option that you can choose from. There are 16 different options that the ads manager gives you. Now, both text and image ads are meant to direct traffic onto your destination pages, whether that be on, say, a landing page where you're collecting leads, on a transaction page, or onto your app, etc. It's meant for you to redirect users onto your properties. So it's completely clickable. While there's a call to action, click anywhere on the ad unit and you will be redirected to your destination pages. And one recommendation that we always provide for both text and image ads is that you should always customize or A/B test the creative to have a question and answer format as well, where, for example, the headline copy becomes a question and the body copy becomes an answer. So for example, if you look at this particular example, it could have been customized into what are the smart luggage options for the modern traveler, and the body copy provides the answer to that. The reason for this is that Quora is, at the end of the day, a question and answer format platform. So when you customize it into questions and answers, we've seen that engagement rates can significantly improve. So the image ads are very similar, but also allow you to add a hero image within the creative itself. And you also get to add a brand logo within the creative. So the same recommendations are there for image ads as well. Tailor it into a question and answer format for better engagement. Click anywhere on the image ad and it will redirect you to your destination pages. And one other crucial aspect of image ads is that, unlike other social and search platforms, we do not have a restriction of only 20% of the image being restricted for any sort of copy to be added within the image. That is because A, Quora is a textual platform by default, so we didn't see any sense in keeping that restriction. And we've actually seen in our internal test insights that having a certain amount of copy within the image, especially when the ad unit is structured into a question and answer format, can actually be quite useful in terms of deepening engagement levels with the image ad. So while we don't recommend that you cram the image entirely with text copies, but certain kinds of tailoring where there's a certain amount of messaging that highlights, say, offer details, and where the headline copy is a question, but your image itself is the answer, and the body copy simply provides more details, can be a more insightful way to provide additional information for your users. Then we come to the most unique and native ad property on Quora, which is called promoted answers. Now, as you all may know, the default content property on Quora is answering questions, right? So what you come to do typically on Quora is either read answers or contribute answers, or of course contribute questions, because both are equally important to us. But what Quora allows you to do as a business is it allows you to promote answers so as to boost your content visibility as well as the engagement levels that you have both across your answers as well as your profile. So like I was mentioning, Quora has now very recently launched a business profile feature as well, which is still in beta. It will come out of beta probably sometime in the middle of this particular quarter itself. But at the moment, if any business is interested in launching a beta or a business profile, you can definitely reach out to us and we can certainly help you and guide you along that process. But you can start creating content on the platform to qualify your users directly within the Quora ecosystem itself, because people come to Quora to find credible and reliable opinions on the platform. So when you promote an answer, you will not, as a user, be taken outside of Quora as a platform, but instead the experience will be that on clicking upon the answer expands so that there's the question, but there's only the brand's answer to that particular question, and then the brand's profile details at the bottom of that specific answer, so that the user can engage fully with the content as well as navigate to the profile and read other answers or other content that the brand has created. So the best approach to take when you're creating content from a credibility and reliability perspective, of course, as a business, is to take the thought leadership approach or the knowledge sharing approach, because you shouldn't make your answers too transactional in nature. Instead, building thought leadership in your category or directly answering questions about your products and businesses as an authority figure is the best approach from a content creation perspective to allow you to grow top of funnel awareness for your products. So there is what we refer to as the Quora flywheel, a process in terms of how you organically start creating content on the platform. When you share your knowledge, you engage with high intent audiences eventually, right? Who discover your content. And as a result, the process is that gradually over a period of time, users start recognizing you as a thought leader within your space. But what the promoted answer actually does is that it accelerates this entire process by allowing you to reach out to relevant, specifically targeted audiences directly at the point of time when you're contributing answers. And therefore, because of that added discoverability, people start browsing your content, start browsing your profile, and there is accelerated engagement and establishment of thought leadership via the promoted answer feature. So these are two examples of approaches that you can take with promoted answers. One is that you contribute from the business profile. So this here is a business profile. This would probably be very tiny for you to be able to identify, but this is a briefcase logo that appears across all business profiles to distinguish them from user profiles on the platform for other users. So when you contribute content from a business profile, take a thought leadership or knowledge sharing approach. Like for example, what IBM Developers is doing here. Or you can also have individuals, what we call surrogates, writing answers on your behalf, where then that particular individual can address more subjective questions, right? That individual should typically be affiliated directly to the business, because that again establishes the credibility and reliability of the answer. But essentially, think of it in this way: when it is about answering questions objectively via thought leadership and knowledge sharing as an approach, you should go for the business profile. When it's about addressing more subjective questions that need human relatability and have a passion point perspective, then answer those questions from an author profile or a writer profile, or what we call a surrogate profile. So these are two ways in which you can have these two different profiles. What you see on the left-hand side is a business profile, whereas what you're seeing on the right-hand side is a user profile. So you can create a business profile and write those answers from a thought leadership perspective, or you can have a user profile and write answers from a more human connect kind of perspective. Finally, around promoted answers, you can also add GIFs, images, as well as videos within the answer itself. So while otherwise our ad formats do not permit video or GIFs, within the promoted answer, you can actually integrate more rich media options. If you have a GIF, that will autoplay. A video does not autoplay, but only plays on click, but it plays natively within the answer itself. So if you already, for example, have certain answers ready for questions that exist on the platform in the form of rich media alternatives, you can easily address those questions in the form of videos added to your answers as well, and then promote them. And finally, there is this one beta that I will quickly leave you guys with. This hasn't rolled out to the market yet, but it's what we call the lead gen form. It's about to roll out sometime early next quarter. This will allow you to collect better quality and a higher volume of leads directly from contextually relevant audiences within the platform. As you can see here on the right-hand side, the experience is that when a user clicks upon the particular ad unit, there are certain preset fields that you can define, up to 12 such potential fields, where you can collect more information from users, and then via automated workflows or workflow integration with Zapier, you can have all of those leads delivered to your CRM. So we will give you more information on request about this particular product as well, but this is currently in beta, can be tested out by a limited number of advertisers. Cool. So that largely concludes the ad products. Now, how do you reach your relevant audience on the platform is going to be something that Anjul will shed more light on. So I will stop sharing my screen here and leave the floor open to Anshul.
Thank you so much, Avirup. Before we proceed, I just want to bring up the second slide of the poll that we're doing quickly. And I'm just doing it. All right. Okay. It will be on your screen shortly. So over to you, Anjun. We are also getting a lot of questions, so we'll keep some time for those questions as well towards the end. Over to you.
Thank you. Thanks, Avirup, for highlighting all the good things about Quora. So now, moving on, we'll be talking about, you know, how do we make use of all the options which are available on Quora, and how do we reach out to the target audience and measure success on the platform. So as you can see here, we broadly categorize targeting and into four different buckets on Quora, starting with contextual, behavioral, audience, and broad. Broadly covering what each one of it means is, on Quora, contextual targeting means that we reach out to our users, you know, who are currently reading about any particular content or any particular topic that we want to target on Quora, so which is a real-time targeting. If we look at behavioral goes back a little into history where a user had engagement history with any of the subject or any of the content that we would like to, you know, target in the past 30 days. Audience targeting is something where we let you create your bucket of audience, which might have worked with you or engaged with you in the past. And broad is where we typically allow you to reach out to each and every user on Quora. So these are the primary options which are available. In addition to this, we do have secondary targeting option where you can layer the primary targeting along with options like a device that you might want to target, a location which you might want to include, or let's say a particular browser which you want to add as well. On top of that, there are options where you can exclude certain parameters. For example, you do not want a certain set of keyword or a certain set of question where your ads to be shown. So we do provide an option where you can exclude that as well. Now let's deep dive further into each of the category as we just discussed. So the number one which we covered is contextual targeting. And as if you can see on the screen, within contextual targeting, we have topic, keyword, and question targeting. So topic targeting is one of the most widely accepted contextual targeting form on Quora and is very, very popular within our advertisers. Reason being, it not only provides a reach, a scale that all of us want, but it also maintains the contextual relevancy, which is very, very important when we talk about achieving our advertising goals. Now, let's take an example. Let's say I'm reading about career development as a topic onto the platform. And as and when I'm still there on the topic, I see an ad from, let's say, a college, an institution, or an organization which allows me to upskill. So that moment, that ad is contextually relevant for me, which is what topic targeting enables us to do. On the left, if you see, there's a video which is playing, which is just nothing but a screenshot of the ads manager, which I'll be talking about in the couple of next slides. Moving on to keyword targeting. So keyword targeting is also a form of contextual targeting where we allow the advertisers to list down a set of questions. A set of keywords which can be later on seen in question that you wish to target. In question targeting, which shows this, it is the most granular form of targeting which is available onto the platform, where it allows advertisers to specifically target a certain set of questions where you want your ads to be seen. Moving on to audience targeting. So as discussed, audience targeting can be clubbed into website traffic audience, lookalike audience, and list match audience. As we see, website audience is nothing but a set of audience which has engaged, which must have engaged with your website in the past, you can opt to either target the entire set of audience, or you know, choose a specific set, which you know, probably a specific URL or specific landing page that you might want to target. Lookalike audience is something where you can create an audience bucket based on you know, the audience that have already worked for you in the Quora Ads Manager. And list match audience is something where you can upload a set of email IDs, as on Quora we capture email addresses when a user logs in or creates an account. So you can upload a set of email IDs, which can later be used to found similar set of audience, and that's how we move on with the targeting. As a form of behavioral targeting, we have interest targeting, keyword history targeting, and question targeting. Now, behavioral targeting is a slight extension of contextual targeting, which has a larger scale, but it is not real time. It depends on the engagement a user must have shown in the past, you know, in the past certain period. On Quora, typically by default, we have it for 30 days. Now, talking about interest in detail, interest targeting targets the users, you know, who have shown or engaged with a certain set of topic or content in the past. It could be any level of engagement, let's say reading about a certain topic or a content, engaging with a question, answering or upvoting any content which is available on the platform. Both keyword history and question history targeting are very, very important, you know, because it somewhere allows us to, you know, reach the audience which has shown strong content, strong intent of engaging with the content in the past. So keyword history and question history allows us to retarget the users who have engaged with a particular set of question or a particular set of keyword in the past. With broad targeting, as we just said that this is something where it is great in terms of reaching out to each and every user on Quora. This is very specifically used by advertisers when it comes to, you know, traffic generation or awareness campaigns. As Avirup covered in a couple of slides before that, you know, how moderation is taken very, very seriously onto the platform. So we have a very, very robust moderation team in place, which takes care of how content goes onto the platform. And the great thing to see is how each and every user on Quora takes a great ownership of reporting content as well. So we have a strong policy known as be nice, be respectful onto the platform, which means that the content not only goes through a manual process or an automated process, it is being flagged by individuals as well. So that is why you will always see the quality of content that we see onto the platform is really great and relevant. Now, how do we, once we have decided that what targeting options we are going to use, how do we select that which bidding method is most suitable for us as depending on our advertising goals? So to begin with, we recommend starting with the cost per click method, which allows, you know, Quora platform to understand the user audience which is engaging with the content, with the ads that we are hosting onto the platform. Once we have the understanding of what audience is engaging, we can always move on to the CPA action goal, which is available. In addition to that, we do have CPM as one of the bidding method which is available. While setting up campaigns, we do recommend making use of the tools which are available. One of the most important tool being the tracking pixel, because once we have the tracking mechanism in place, that is where it makes it much, much easier for the platform to understand what kind of audience engages, what is the success rate, how do I amplify the effect, and how do I make sure that we provide more and more relevant users engage with your content or with your creatives. So these are some of the things, for example, setting up advanced match or conversion window. These are something that we take on case to case basis. So depending on the goal or requirement is how we can discuss this at a later stage. Now talking about where do we see the ads, when where do we see the targeting? We have a pretty strong tool called Quora Ads Manager, which allows us to create campaigns, monitor the performance, observe the data real time, understand, you know, how each metric is performing, and also, optimize and make recommendation, make changes on the go. What we also have is a great auction, a great way to understand how our ads are performing with Auction Insights, which is pretty unique to Quora, which basically helps us understand that what percentage of the audience am I able to reach? Of that, what is the kind of impact that I've been able to make? Once we have that data, which really helps us, change gears and make changes, which ultimately helps us derive a better performance. These are some of our marketing partners, which we have already tied up with. We have some of the very popular partners are like Google Tag Manager, Branch, Ochava, etc. These come into use at different stages of the campaigns. These are some of the brands which are already there on Quora. These are just a few, as we cannot list everything over here, but some of the options, some of the brands that are already leveraging Quora and have seen great success with us. I'm going to stop now and just see if we have any set of questions.
Sorry, thank you, Anjul. Thank you for this wonderful presentation. Truly a gold mine of information, so much to learn and so much for the brands to leverage. We do have a lot of questions, however, given the time that we have, I've chosen some. So I can start, maybe we can all have you on screen, both of you, and I'll start my questions. First question I'll ask you, Avirup, it is from Inakshi Das Gupta. What about food conversation, health and wellness conversation? What are the stats? The deck we email will have health and wellness, see 69 million topic views. That's the question, basically.
Got it. Yes, so that is also a massive category on India and on health and wellness in Quora. In fact, so that is one of the key categories that has seen an explosion over the last 6 months, right? Especially obviously because of the concerns around COVID-19 and what people are doing to adapt to those concerns and how they need to take care of themselves given the present lockdown scenarios, right? So we have seen massive growth there, and for any advertisers or for any brand who needs to understand more about those categories, we can share very relevant data specifically focusing on say the category of information that is relevant to them. But yes, right. Massive category of content consumption on the platform at the moment.
Right. This is Avirup for you again, this question from Kalyani Vatak. What is the criteria for call to action links? I think that's what she means to say. It is for you.
Sure. So call to action links can essentially be embedded within, of course, the image and text ad units. There are 16 different call to action buttons within each of these ad units, which can essentially be customized for the messaging that you want to deliver. So let's say that, for example, you want to drive audiences towards the subscription of your services. So you can actually tailor it to having buy now as the call to action option. Or for example, if you want to generate leads, then you can drive the call to action, learn more. Or if you want, say from a BFSI advertiser's perspective, you want people to get quotes. So we have a specific call to action saying get quotes, right? So within the image and text ad units, we have each of these specific call to actions that are already predefined. And even apart from that, if you're doing answers, you can always add links to the answer itself in your content as a footnote. We don't recommend that answers are spammed with links all across, but you can, after you've answered the question comprehensively, add links and footnotes as well to drive users to your landing or destination pages.
Right. For you, Anjul, the question is from RM is only written. Is Hindi content also translated into other languages, basically regionals? Yeah.
So we do have, a bunch of regional languages. However, that's not something we are monetizing at the moment. And no, there is no, that's not getting translated to English at the moment. Each and every vernacular language is treated, individually onto the platform.
Okay. He has a follow-up question again. Can a person who opted for English as primary language follow a person whose language preference is a different language?
Absolutely. So we do not restrict a user, depending on what is your preferred language. You're absolutely free to navigate onto the platform and, look around who can influence you, what type of content you would like to read and so on. So that's totally up to a user, what they want to read and who they want to follow.
Right. So I have another question. So whoever wants to take this, what is the maximum size of video that can be attached to an answer?
So there's no limit there. So within an answer, you can add whatever video that you want to embed from other platforms, right? Because we are not a native video platform, we don't have a native video player. That means that we don't have any restrictions of our own. So you can just embed your YouTube link or your Vimeo link or any other video platform that you're currently running your videos on within the answer, and that will play just like it would within that native video player. So no specific restrictions there.
Great. Riddhi Mittal has this question. How do we see the performance of image ads in Quora?
So that's exactly what Anjul, I think, took us through in terms of being able to see on the self-serve ads manager, all the details around how your image ads are actually performing, where you can effectively look at the CPCs, the CTRs. You can A-B test with different kinds of creative formats, different images, different headline and sentence copies, and analyze which ones are performing better. And the system also optimizes for producing results and delivering more impressions and traffic to the creatives that work better.
So we have time, we'll take more questions. There's a question, what is Quora's policy on media dark categories like AlcoBev or tobacco? What is your policy on them?
Sure, so great question. So at the moment, we do have certain restrictions on these kind of categories. So you cannot directly advertise for these products, just as is the case with the larger online ad industry. But on a case-to-case basis, if there is surrogate messaging that is being put out by these advertisers, where it's not directly linked to the tobacco product or not directly linked to, say, the alcohol beverage product, then we can take a look and we can accommodate exceptions. But by and large, the category does have restrictions if the direct products are being advertised.
Right. There's another question. One second. Yes. What should be the minimum ad spend budget? What will be the reach criteria?
Sure. So a recommended pilot budget is in the 3 to 5 lakh range, especially around performance campaigns. That's primarily because this is a budget that we've seen works best when you want to scale your campaigns with the right kind of efficiency. Because what the system needs is both time as well as the necessary budgets to deliver on your performance goals, because Quora's learning mechanism is one where it will first look at a broader audience and then, after identifying the audience that performs, scale on efficiency.
Right. There's a question from Tushar Gagabe. Is remarketing possible through Quora pixels?
Absolutely. Yeah, go for it, Anjul.
I will take this. Yes. So definitely. So as, I'm sorry if I missed covering that point. So definitely. So having pixel in place is a must have feature, that we insist all our performance advertisers to implement. And yes, remarketing is possible. In fact, there are more ways of, utilizing the pixel, not just remarketing, but also understanding that, how each and every ad is performing onto the platform and how can we define, our next steps based on that. So yep, a pixel has more and more roles to play.
You know, I'm getting so many questions. Honestly, it's such a lovely scene to see. I hope we can answer as many. There's one from Suchi Shah. I have a travel company. Which audience targeting option will be more relevant to me?
So Suchi, I would love to connect with you one-on-one after this call. I think there we can have a longer discussion. But, you know, so travel as is an interesting category. So we can obviously have people directly who have engaged with, you know, topics like travel, backpacking, et cetera, et cetera. On the contrary, you know, it is important to find out secondary, you know, interest options. Like, let's say, what do I need when I travel? I need a cab, right? So I need to figure out options that how do I commute? What are some of the things that are very, very relevant for travel? But yes, there are more that I can share when we chat one-on-one, but not on the platform.
Priya Jain has a question. What would you recommend to start a new campaign with behavioral targeting, or first test the contextual options and let's understand what works better for the brand on Quora?
Well, I love this question. So in fact, Priya, both options should go hand in hand, because, you know, we strongly recommend starting with both, because what happens is, as we say, contextual gives you an audience that is absolutely focused and intended, you know, to do or, you know, to immediately engage with what you're trying to present. However, behavioral is equally important, because sometimes what happens, we are not very quick in making a decision. So it obviously takes us some time to read, research. So having both contextual and, you know, behavioral goes hand in hand. And at times we've been surprised where we've seen behavioral going way better than contextual. So I would recommend starting with both. And as and when we mature in the campaign, we will be in a better position to take a call which one works for us over the other.
So 7 minutes and 50 questions I have, but I won't be able to do all of them. So as many. So Karan Jodhani has a question. How can one promote normal profiles on Quora? Also, do we need to set an ad account for that? What is the budget? I think that was like minimum, but he has this, you know.
Sure. So Anjali, I'll take this one very quickly. So you can promote a usual profile on Quora just in the way that you would promote a business profile on the platform. Essentially, promotion is in the form of promoting content via the promoted answers product, right? So there's no way to just directly promote a profile for follower acquisition like you would perhaps on other platforms. But that's because the pattern of engagement on Quora is one where people first discover your content and then decide whether or not your profile is worth following for engaging on a more regular basis. So our ad product is also designed in the same way, where you can promote your answers to relevant audiences using the targeting parameters that Anju just covered. And then people will automatically start following your profiles on the basis of the kind of relevance that they're seeing in your content. And yes, we would need to set up a thread line for you to be able to do that. The pilot budget recommendations have already been mentioned. You can try with something like that. You can try with something higher, depending upon like what levels of engagement you're seeing and the results that you're driving out of the product.
Right. Raja Balasubramanian has a question. Can you give us examples of brands that have started conversations successfully on Quora, especially in the area of finance?
Sure thing. So finance has actually been very active on Quora from even before when we became officially active in India, which is 1st of April 2020. So we have businesses such as State Bank of India, ICICI Prudential Mutual Fund, HDFC Life, and many other businesses who've not only established their own profiles on the platform, but regularly contribute content and also advertise with image and text ads to generate performance. So BFSI and education actually happen to be two of our largest categories, while we've diversified with many other categories as well on the platform from an advertising standpoint.
Right. Kamal Sajnani, how relevant is Quora marketing for a B2B tech product introduced in a largely archaic industry such as media production?
So great question there. So the relevance of Quora really is about finding the right audience on the platform, right? So B2B actually happens to be one of the categories which is one of our strong points, because in the B2B category, you will find that a lot of users come to do research on the platform, even on niche topics such as yours, right? So if we can find, and we can, you know, connect on this offline, like Anjali was mentioning as well, what can be done here is that for any specific requirement, we look at, say, the relevant topics and the questions and keywords available on the platform, which indicates to us the audience available for that specific topic of discussion. And then we are able to target accordingly to deliver more relevant results for you.
So many questions. I can start a quiz show after this. So there's one more, which is from SM Meenakshi, which is more effective for travel category, CPC, CPM, or CPA, CPL?
Anjali, you want to take this?
Yes. So I think we typically would recommend starting everything with the cost per click, CPC, as we just covered in a couple of slides back. Reason being, because Quora is a RTB platform, and it is very, very important to understand that, you know, who our audience is, and what kind of competition do we have in the space, et cetera, et cetera. Also, why we should start any campaign with the cost per click is because it allows our system to go through a learning phase, which is very, very beneficial for any campaign journey in the longer term. Because only once a system or the platform understands, you know, your requirement is when we will be able to replicate the same and amplify the same behavior to give you, you know, similar results, you know, at a lesser price, or, you know, or rather a more optimized price in the longer run. So to answer your question in short, start with CPC and then explore other options as you go forward.
Two more minutes. We have a question is, can we see India specific questions? Is there such filter on Quora?
Sure. So the thing is, what you get to see, especially within the ad manager, is the India specific audience on questions as well as topics and other keywords. The thing is, by definition, all content on Quora is global in nature. It is not restricted to a specific geo. But when you're advertising on the platform, you will be able to see the audience on that specific set of questions or that specific set of topics that is within your relevant geo. That could be an India-specific audience, that could be a state-level audience, that could be even city-specific audiences, or you could target to audiences globally as well. So while the content is global, the targeting is definitely local.
There's a question, the username is not given. What scenario would you use business profile, or in what scenario is it better to use an expert to answer a promoted question?
Sure. So very quickly, because I think we have only 1 minute left. Essentially, it's all about determining on the basis of what would be the most reliable, credible way to answer a question. So the shorthand rule is that when the question is objective in nature and when the perspective is thought leadership and knowledge sharing, then the business profile is the better way to approach those questions. Whereas when the question is slightly more subjective in nature, let's say that there is a comparison between three different brands, then an executive associated with the business who presents from a humane perspective, right? A relatable perspective, why they believe their business has certain trump cards, etc., and was designed in a specific way. Those kind of subjective questions can be answered better from a user profile. So that's the shorthand rule: subjective user profiles, objective business profiles.
Thank you, Abhirup. Thank you, Anjul. We're out of time and we still have a lot of questions. We'll try to send it across to you. It's been a great discussion and so much to learn and so much to apply actually, you know, here. Thank you once again for your time for this conversation.
Thanks a lot, Rohail and team, and thank you so much, attendance. It was absolutely a pleasure interacting with all of you.
Thank you. Thanks a lot, everyone.